Good morning, and thank you for joining us for this episode in the Museum's Facebook Live series. I'm your host, historian Edna Friedberg. Today, we are commemorating Disability Awareness Month by discussing one of the Nazis' first victim groups, people with physical or mental disabilities. Not only did the Nazis implement a plan of systematic murder against these German citizens, this deadly project also served as a testing ground for killing techniques used later in the Holocaust against millions of other innocent people. Please join me in welcoming today's guest, my friend and colleague, Dr. Patricia Heberer, senior historian at the museum. Good morning, Patricia.
Good morning, Edna. It's great to see you again.
Always happy when you are with us on the show. Patricia is one of the world's experts on this topic and will help us unpack this painful and complex chapter in Holocaust history. During today's show, please post your questions for Patricia in the comments section, and we'll get to as many of them live as we have time for. Now, Patricia, in many ways, the Nazis in the 1930s were in step with many popular scientific opinions. How did they use what was then a commonly accepted scientific theory to justify abusing people with disabilities?
Right, and so the German medical community at that time embraced the internationally acclaimed eugenics movement to kind of fortify and maintain desirable characteristics in their racial community as they saw it, and to try and root out those traits that would taint that community. And here we see some photographs of Nazi eugenicists employing racial examinations of young women, examining their eyes and hair color for racial type. And today we see eugenics as a pseudoscience, but we have to remember that it was thought of at the time as cutting edge science. Eugenics claimed that society's ills, criminality, mental illness, alcoholism, even poverty, were hereditary in nature. The Nazis used eugenics to justify and try to achieve the goal of creating a superior German race, cleansing it of unwanted deficiencies, and eliminating hereditary diseases from the gene pool where they could. In 1934, the hereditary health law went into effect, which allowed Nazi authorities to forcibly sterilize people with a wide variety of mental disabilities, ranging from schizophrenia to feeble-mindedness, an ambiguous term that today would embrace a broad spectrum of intellectual disabilities. And the law also permitted these very invasive sterilization procedures to be performed on people with neurological or physical conditions, including epilepsy and hereditary deafness or blindness. It's estimated that about 400,000 Germans were sterilized in Nazi Germany under this law.
So in essence, the Nazis were employing what we might think of as kind of selective breeding that people might use with plants or with animals, but they were using it on human beings, right?
Right, exactly. And the Nazis believed that people with disabilities were not only threats to the Nazi state, but also a financial burden, in some cases, of life unworthy of life, as the Nazis called them. And this thinking eventually developed into the Nazis' first program of mass murder, the so-called euthanasia program, which targeted institutionalized patients with disabilities. And when we talk about euthanasia today, this is not mercy killing or assisted death, as we would call it in our bioethics debate today, but a cynical program of mass murder that targeted disabled patients for murder. And here we're looking at a little girl, one of the victims of the Nazis' child euthanasia program. This little girl was murdered at the Eichberg pediatric facility after being diagnosed with hereditary feeble-mindedness, which is an intellectual disability. By October 1939, a child euthanasia program began in which children with disabilities were murdered in specified pediatric facilities through a lethal overdose of medication, sometimes to by starvation. And a few months later, the euthanasia program is extended to adults, patients with disabilities. And in its initial phase, there were six centralized killing facilities where patients were gassed. And at least 250,000 patients were murdered in this euthanasia program, which is also known at this stage, this gassing stage, as T4. And the street address of the office where the program is organized, Tiergartenstrasse 4, a very posh neighborhood in Berlin, gave the program its code name.
250,000 people killed is a very hard number to grasp. We saw that sweet little girl whose photo was just up on the screen. It's hard to imagine that someone would want to kill her or would see her as dangerous. Let's put another face to this history. Tell us about a little boy named Robert Wagemann.
Yeah, so here you see Robert Wagemann. He was born in 1937 in Mannheim, Germany, and there were some complications during his birth. And his mother, Lotte, Charlotte, was a Jehovah's Witness. And when she was pregnant with Robert, she was arrested for distributing religious leaflets, and that was illegal at the time. And she was treated very harshly and held in prison, often without food or water for long periods. And Lotte gave birth to Robert several days after being released from prison. She didn't have proper medical attention when she gave birth, and this resulted in a birth trauma. Robert's right hip was shattered during delivery, and that injury really wasn't detected at first, but when he was about 4 years old, it became apparent that that damage was permanent and irreparable. And as a physically disabled child, Robert was then, of course, a potential target for this child euthanasia program when it started in 1939.
Let's take a look at a clip of Robert many years later as an adult describing a close call he had with doctors in Germany who were supposed to be caring for him, treating him.
My mom and I were summoned to a part of the university clinic in Heidelberg in Schlierheim. There I was examined, and during the examination my mom was sitting on the outside of the room. And she overheard the conversation that the doctors would do away with me, would abspritz me, which means that it would give me a needle and put me asleep. My mom overheard the conversation, and during lunchtime, while the doctors were gone, she grabbed hold of me. We went down to the Neger River into the high reeds, and there she put my clothes on. And from there on, we really went into hiding, because now we knew that they really were after us.
That is just a wrenching scene to picture. As a mother myself, I cannot imagine how it would feel knowing that someone in the next room was planning to kill my son. Lotta's quick thinking, her bravery, ultimately saved Robert's life. He was luckier than many other patients with a physical disability at the time. Patricia, we have an audience question. There are many, many comments coming in about Charlotta Wagemann in her rescue of her son. Suzanne is asking if his mom also survived the war.
Yes, she did. And we know that even though Robert was able to evade the Nazis' direct plan to kill him, shortly after escaping, Robert and Lotte, Charlotte, went to live with the paternal grandparents in a town called Ingelheim on the Rhine River. It wasn't long before they captured the attention of local Nazis. And here you see Robert as a young boy, very cute. And the first day that Robert attends school in the town, he refused to sing the national anthem, the German national anthem, or give the Nazi salute, because he's a Jehovah's Witness, and Jehovah's Witnesses don't recognize temporal authority, the authority of the state, only the authority of God. So Robert feels that singing the national anthem would have been a breach of his faith. So the next day, local authorities come looking for Robert and his mom at his grandfather's house. And while his grandfather stood up to them and got them to leave, Robert and Lotte realized they weren't safe remaining there. And they moved to a house in the woods, their secure food from Robert's maternal grandparents this time, in their farm until the end of the war. And Robert survives, Lotte survives, Robert eventually marries, moves to the United States, and has three sons and several grandchildren.
And Robert's story reminds us that the Nazis targeted many different groups, and in quite a few cases, Robert's is one of them, a person might fall into more than one category of a victim or someone who was in danger.
Absolutely.
I want to pause for a moment to welcome visitors. Sorry, not visitors. I'm used to a physical museum. Welcome viewers who are watching from all over the U.S. and all over the world. Good morning to you in Dartmouth, Massachusetts, Richmond, Kentucky, Bluffdale, Texas, Portland, Oregon, Montevideo, Minnesota, Harrisburg, Pennsylvania. And we'd also like to thank you for joining us internationally. We have people watching in Halifax, Canada, Manila, Philippines, and also in the country of Portugal. We're so glad that you are here with us. Now, Patricia, it's very hard to believe that anyone could hurt, let alone kill, such an innocent child like Robert. Who came up with this deadly plan? And remember, it is a state-sponsored plan. These are not individual criminals.
Right, in a clandestine program. The euthanasia program wouldn't have been possible without the willing participation of physicians like the pediatrician Werner Kattel. He's considered, and there you see him in his white coat, he's considered one of the architects of the child euthanasia program. In 1933, that's the same year the Nazis come to power, Kattel becomes director of a pediatric clinic at the University of Leipzig in Eastern Germany. And a few years later, in 1939, an infant with severe disabilities is brought to Kattel's clinic. Werner Kattel already supported the idea of child euthanasia well before the Nazis. And he persuades the children's parents to write to Hitler and request a mercy death for their baby. And Hitler's personal physician, Dr. Karl Brandt, is sent to Leipzig to determine whether the child is incurable, and he authorizes a procedure to put this child to sleep. You see here Dr. Karl Brandt. He later becomes one of the two heads of the entire euthanasia program, the adult euthanasia program. And Kattel is thought to have, with this authorization from Brandt, he's thought to have carried out the mercy killing himself by giving the infant an overdose of medication. And this incident is thought to be the inspiration for child euthanasia. Kattel is one of the three men who directs the child euthanasia program, which results in the deaths, the murders of about 10,000 children.
And I want to reiterate, especially for people who might be joining us in the middle, that many of the terms you're using are euphemisms, are code words that the Nazis used. Even the idea of euthanasia, which supposedly means good death or mercy killing or incurable. These are Nazi terms, not ours. Also, Patricia, as familiar as I've been with this history for quite a few years and learned a lot from you, I didn't realize until today that Hitler actually directly authorized murders like these.
Yes, that's right.
So was Dr. Kattel ever held accountable for his crimes?
Dr. Kattel literally got away with murder. He continued to work in the field of medicine after the war, as did many, many other doctors involved in the euthanasia program. Two proceedings against him were set aside in West German courts and a denazification court, which is tasked really with removing Nazis from prominent positions in society, exonerates Kattel, saying he's a convinced anti-fascist and a representative of humanity in the Third Reich, if you can imagine that. In less than a decade after the war, Kattel is appointed as a high-ranking professor of pediatrics at the University of Kiel in northern Germany. And although he's never convicted of his crimes, bad press dogs him everywhere. And he takes an early retirement in 1960 to dodge criticism from many of his colleagues and from the press. And he never expressed remorse for his action. He remains an enthusiastic supporter of child euthanasia. He continues to publicly advocate, if you can imagine this, to publicly advocate for the killing of children with disabilities, still considering them to be less than human. And here you see a picture of Werner Kattel in an interview. He's given an interview with the popular German magazine, Der Spiegel, which is kind of similar to our Time magazine here in the United States. Kattel dies in 1981, and the University of Kiel recognized him in his obituary as having, quote, contributed to the well-being of children, end quote. But after his death, Kattel continues to bring trouble to the university because he's donated 500,000 German marks. That's about $250,000 back then. It's a lot of money. He's donated that to the university to endow a Werner Kattel prize. Thank goodness, ultimately, the university senate unanimously rejects this offer and the money. And today, the University of Kiel condemns Werner Kattel's role as in child euthanasia.
It's really shocking that even after he was able to evade justice, Kattel remained unrepentant. He was a hardcore true believer, And we have a question from a viewer named Joseph. He was asking about what happened to Dr. Cattell after the war. The answer is sadly really nothing. Or very little. He was even able to continue practicing as a physician, which just adds a very, very disturbing and unjust postscript to what is already a horrific story. Now, Patricia, you had mentioned earlier that this deadly program was later extended to adults with disabilities too. Please tell us about a young woman named Helene Melanie Lebel.
Helene Lebel was born in Vienna in 15th of September, 1911. You see her here with her younger sister, Emma. She lived a normal life in Austria. She was affectionately called Heli by her family. And here you see a picture of her family. She, her sister Emma, she lived with her mother and her stepfather. They were Catholic. They look like they're having fun in this photograph. And Helene grows up to become a bright, beautiful woman who loves opera. She studies to be a lawyer, which is quite uncommon in those days. And she's working as in her late teens as a legal secretary while she's going to law school. And at the age of 19, she begins to manifest symptoms of mental illness, and she begins a psychiatric treatment. And here you see Helene. Her condition really worsens in her mid-20s, and she suffers a major breakdown after her dog, whom you see her with, Liddy, dies, and her little terrier. And Helene was diagnosed with schizophrenia thereafter, and she's admitted into Vienna's famous psychiatric hospital, Am Steinhof, in 1936 for treatment. And Emma and her family visit Helene a few times, mother and sister. The last time they saw her was right before the Nazis annexed Austria in 1938.
I'd like to give special thanks and gratitude to Irene Wittig, a relative of Helena's, who has very graciously shared these touching family photos with us. They help us to remember Helene and also in all of her humanity, that she was just, you know, someone's beloved sister and daughter, a little girl who liked to stick out her tongue and who had ambitions for the future. How did the Nazi takeover of Austria, the annexation in 1938, affect Helena's medical treatment?
Well, right. By 1940, of course, Austria is now, as you say quite correctly, Austria is now a part of Germany. And in 1940, Helena's mother is told that she's been transferred to another psychiatric hospital further away in Bavaria, in southern Germany. But according to the Nazi records, we know that she was probably sent to Brandenburg. That's what is on her medical records. Brandenburg was a euthanasia facility that had been established in a former jail about an hour's drive outside of Berlin. And there Helene was gassed, although the official cause on her death certificate says that she dies of acute schizophrenic excitement. Of course, that's a lie.
And this was a very common form of deception employed by the Nazi regime. The families of those patients who were killed were typically, always actually, given a false cause of death. They were also often given a false date or a false location in an effort to even more obscure what had actually happened to their loved ones. So we can't actually be certain when Helene was murdered or if it actually even occurred in Brandenburg, right?
Right, exactly. They played a shell game with these different killing centers.
Patricia, I want you to know that in the comment section, there's lively conversation going on. People are identifying with these difficult stories on a very personal level. A woman named Marcia writes, "My little grandson has Down syndrome, and to read this breaks my heart. God help us." Similarly, a viewer named Darlene writes that she had polio as an infant. "I'm sure I would have been murdered had I been born there."
Yes, indeed.
And, that's exactly right.
Yeah.
Patricia, you had mentioned specifically Brandenburg as one of these so-called euthanasia facilities where people with disabilities were sent, but not for treatment, only for death. Tell us who ran Brandenburg and how many people were murdered under this program.
Yeah, so Brandenburg is, as you've said, one of six killing centers, euthanasia centers operating in Germany. And Dr. Imfried Eberl, as you see him there in his white coat, he was the director of this facility, this gassing facility. Remember, it is a place where people come to be murdered. He was only 30 years old when he was appointed the director of Brandenburg. This was actually pretty common. Many of these physicians involved in the euthanasia program are quite young, actually. Even though he was a very mediocre medical student, Dr. Heberer was a devoted member of the Nazi Party and was zealous about his role in the euthanasia program. And here he is. This is at one of the two euthanasia facilities, I'm not sure which, that he worked on during the Holocaust, accompanied by nurses on either side of him. And by February 1940, he begins coordinating the mass killing of adults, German patients with disabilities in Brandenburg. Remember, it's a clandestine program. And his success with this particular facility led him to his next appointment when Brandenburg closes as the head of the euthanasia center located in a psychiatric hospital in Bernburg. Several months later, Bernburg is in the state of Saxony in eastern Germany. You see a photograph of that there, the Bernburg facility. And here, Dr. Heberer implements and manages the killing program again. And he assigns, one of the things he does is assign the victims causes of death, which appear in the death certificates, as you quite rightly say. And then these are, of course, falsified or fictive causes of death. And there are about 250,000 victims killed in the euthanasia program.
I think it would feel much more comfortable to imagine that these murders were somehow committed by monsters. But in fact, these are human beings. That first photo you showed of Heberer actually reminds me of photographs of my own grandfather from the era, the style of his hair, the white coat. Yeah. You mentioned how young Heberer was. And clearly these doctors, though, were chosen for their zeal, their ideological commitment, and not their knowledge of medicine. But Dr. Heberer's reputation at these two facilities and his enthusiastic dedication to the deadly cause led to an even bigger assignment. Tell us what he did next.
Right. So I don't know if you'd call it a promotion, but in April 1942, Dr. Heberer was sent to the German occupied part of Poland, in eastern Poland, to become the commandant of Treblinka. That's a killing center in the Holocaust that would claim the lives of as many as 925,000 Jews. That's almost as many as at Auschwitz. Treblinka was one of three killing centers linked to the Nazis' plan to murder Jews living in German-occupied Poland. This operation was known as Operation Reinhardt. Together, Sobibor, Belzec, and Treblinka, those three camps, the vast majority of the German staff at those three camps are manned largely by personnel from the T4 euthanasia program. And Jews are sent there. It's the end station, for example, of the Jews of the Warsaw Ghetto in Treblinka. And at Treblinka, gassing begins in July of 1942. And here's an image of Jews boarding a train from a ghetto in Szczedulza, pardon my Polish, a part of Poland, to Treblinka. Treblinka's near Warsaw. And in order to disguise the murderous operations at Treblinka, Heberer always walks around the camp in his white doctor's coat. Although this is not a medical procedure, this gassing patients, gassing Jews is not a medical procedure, but he thinks that that medical presence provides a calming influence and that people who seeing him would enter the gas chamber disguised as a shower voluntarily in an orderly fashion. And as I said, he's a zealot. He was so ambitious. He wanted to outdo the other two camps in killing more people. So he wanted his camp to kill the most Jews. And so approximately 280,000 Jews are killed in the first 6 weeks that he's in charge of Treblinka. That's an enormous number of individuals. And this very large number of murdered individuals overwhelms the crematory technology that was available. And so the camp staff can't dispose of the thousands of bodies of their victims. And the stench can be smelled for miles, for 10 kilometers. That's a long way. And that threatens to expose this clandestine operation to the locals. It exposes his men to disease. So Heberer is, in fact, fired for his incompetence. And after the war, he tries to hide his involvement with the T4 project.
It's an absolutely disgusting frenzy of murder that you're describing. Yes. Did Heberer successfully cover up his crimes? Was he eventually caught?
He is. In January of 1948, he's arrested finally and interrogated by American authorities that he was gassing patients with disabilities at Bernburg. He was only being held for these euthanasia charges, which at that time, by 1948, these crimes are actually receiving pretty light sentences from German courts, West and East German courts. So the next month, Heberer learns that a former prisoner at Buchenwald, Eugen Kogan, and identified him for killing thousands of Jews at Treblinka, which, of course, would incur a much larger penalty. Here's Eugen Kogan. He was, as I said, a political prisoner at Buchenwald, very influential in the post-war. He writes a book, The Theory and Practice of Hell. And in this book, he identifies Heberer, as the first commandant at Treblinka. Remember, they're holding him for his crimes in euthanasia. And so the next morning, Heberer finds out that his crimes have been exposed, and he hangs himself in his cell.
There's a certain kind of horrific absurdity in thinking, oh, he's only being held for the murders of thousands and thousands of people rather than hundreds of thousands of people. I mean, it's just defies any kind of humanity.
Yes.
I want to pause for a moment to acknowledge a viewer named Pat, whose husband's older cousin had a similar experience to Helena's. Pat writes that the boy's parents were told the doctors wanted to take him to a health and treatment sanitarium. The cousin never returned. His parents received a letter stating that he died in the sanitarium, and his cousin was a statistic of the Nazi euthanasia program, T4. Thank you for sharing that story, and we hope that we can in some small way pay tribute to the memory of your family member. We have an audience question here, Patricia, from Catherine asking, did the killing of disabled people continue throughout the war once the killing methods were so-called perfected?
Yes, they continue throughout the war. There's a brief pause in 1941 through 1942. And then the euthanasia killing apparatus starts up again in approximately the summer of 1942 and extends to the end of the war. Basically, they're employing the much more commonly used methods in child euthanasia. They're not gassing patients anymore, but they're murdering them with lethal overdoses of medication, sometimes too, by starvation.
And Patricia, if I'm remembering correctly, the pause that you just mentioned was due in part actually to public protests, right? To family members who were suspicious that something was going on?
Yep. Catholic and Protestant officials. So there was public knowledge of this euthanasia program that forced its closure for a while the planners of euthanasia tried to knock out the kinks.
I think that that's a very revealing and important element to remind people of, because it's tempting to think of the Nazi regime as some sort of natural disaster, like a tsunami. Once it starts, there's nothing that could be done. But in fact, the Nazis, like any government, were sensitive to public opinion, were testing the limits of what they could get away with in a murderous way. And this shows that, in fact, intervention and standing up could actually have a life-saving impact. Now, Patricia, our audience may be getting the impression, given the stories that we've shared so far, that only men were involved in murdering people with physical or mental disabilities, but many women participated too, right?
Yeah, this is a photograph of Irmgard Huber. She was the chief nurse, head nurse, female nurse at the Hadamar euthanasia facility near Frankfurt, where about 15,000 patients were murdered from 1941 to 1945. She's in charge of the pharmacy there. And so she's doling out the medication with which patients are murdered from 1942 to 1945 by lethal overdoses of medication. And we have a group of nurses here, her nursing staff, who also worked at the facility. And it's really in the euthanasia program that women actually factor into the killing program for the first time. Sure, there are concentration camp guards, but most concentration camp guards, most women aren't involved in shooting or in gassing Jews during the Holocaust, but it's here that women actually enter into killing because they're murdering patients at these euthanasia facilities between 1942 and 1945. And it's important to note that these female nurses were not involved in the killing centers of the Final Solution, where Imfurt Eberl went, that focused on murdering Jews and the other later in the war. That was not a factor where female nurses were sent.
It's so disturbing, though, to think about the abuse of and the perversion of trust that people, especially parents of children or someone with a vulnerable relative, an adult, would place in medical personnel and that they abuse that. I'm struck in some of the stories that we've read also that in the way that Eberl's white coat might have given a false sense of order and confidence to people deported to a killing center. Here in these clinical settings, a nurse might be perceived as, you know, maternal, as a nurturing caregiver, and instead it's the opposite. Now, Patricia, in addition to Eberl, do we know how many other perpetrators followed a similar career path of beginning by murdering people with disabilities and later murdering Jews during the Holocaust? Was this common?
It was pretty common. There were about 100 T4 operatives that go to German-occupied Poland to work in the Operation Reinhardt. Eberl was the only physician, but there were also male nurses. Remember, female nurses do not go, but male nurses went, as did crematory staff, kitchen staff, T4 administrators. So a lot of these individuals who worked at T4 centers are sent to be the main German staff in those killing centers that murdered Jews. And most weren't tried or got very light sentences for their crimes later, in the mainly in the 1960s.
So there's really this kind of direct route that in a way the T4 facilities functioned as a proving ground to see which people would follow through, who could stomach it, who could keep the secret.
Right, exactly. That's exactly right. And those planners of the Final Solution, they really borrow a lot of the technology and tactics from the euthanasia program. And they drew on sort of the gassing techniques that are available, were developed for the euthanasia program. The T4 operation used pure carbon monoxide gas, chemically produced. And the planners of the Final Solution, the murder of Jews, used carbon monoxide gases at places like Treblinka, generated by diesel exhaust. And they expand the crematory technology that's used to burn the number of bodies in a large number of victims. They use the camouflage techniques that lure the victims into a false sense of security at the very door of the gas chamber. Think of those gas chambers disguised as showers. And these people are also politically reliable, as you've said, Edna, and they have the zeal and they're inured to the killing process. So they're the perfect personnel for these killing centers that have this much more ambitious project of murdering Jews in the millions.
Well, as profoundly disturbing and unpleasant as it is to examine this piece of the history, Patricia, I really do want to thank you for helping us to contextualize, also to see that there is an interconnectedness among various parts of Nazi ideology and Nazi crimes. And we appreciate so much your time and your clear way of explaining. Thank you.
Thank you. And it's a joy to be with you.
Always. We also want to acknowledge a couple of audience comments. Rosemary writes, thank you for keeping these historical stories alive. And Mary writes, good to hear these stories to remind us that these are real human beings with lives and families, not just numbers. Perfectly put, Mary. Thank you, Rosemary. It is our honor during Disability Awareness Month to pay tribute to make sure that this aspect of Nazi crimes is not forgotten, and also to hear how these early victims of Nazi aggression, that their deaths played a crucial role in what eventually became genocide. Also, a lot of gratitude to Patricia. It is thanks to her direct research and that of others in the field that we can understand these connections. We hope that learning about this history will serve as a reminder that medical communities, scientific researchers must remain vigilant to protect the most vulnerable among us. Thank you for watching with us today, and we invite you to join us for our next program, which will take place on a different day of the week, on Monday, October 25th at 9:30 a.m. Eastern Time, where we will be hearing about the greatest theft in history, the Nazi plot to strip Jews of their art, furnishings, and even objects of little value wasn't only about greed and delusions of grandeur. It was also an attempt to wipe out an entire culture and rewrite history. So we hope you will join us again on October 25th for that fascinating conversation. And until then, be safe and well wherever you are. Bye-bye.